Last week, Florida Governor Rick Scott proposed ideas to help prevent a tragedy like we saw in Parkland from ever happening again. Included in that plan, new restrictions on purchasing firearms that raises the minimum purchasing age to 21. He's also asking for $450 million for more law enforcement officers at schools and added security measures, plus another $50 million for mental health initiatives. They are proposals the governor says he knows not everyone will agree with, but whatever the plan, he says it is necessary for the state to do something now.
We all have a difficult task in front of us, balancing our individual rights with our obvious need for public safety. But of course, some will say it's too much, and some will say it's not enough. I respect everyone's opinion, and I don't ridicule those who disagree with me. An open dialogue is critical. But I will not accept the old tired political notion that we don't have enough time to get anything done. Government does not have to be slow or lethargic. And when it comes to protecting our schools and our kids, we need to be swift and decisive.
Joining me now to help break down the governor's plan, as well as the latest on pending state legislation that's being voted on this week, are Brian Fonseca, director of the Jack D. Gordon Institute for Public Policy at FIU, and Areto Imoukhuede, professor of law at Nova Southeastern's Shepard Broad College of Law. Gentlemen, thank you both so much for being here with us. We really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, Pam.
A lot to talk about here, very sensitive subject, a lot of powerful emotions on both sides of this issue. Brian, I want to speak with you first. You were at a forum that was held at FIU earlier this week. It was called Gun Violence in America, and it basically brought in people from different disciplines to talk about this issue as a whole. So tell us a little bit more about what was discussed.
Yeah, absolutely. So FIU organized a discussion among, it's really an interdisciplinary group of people to talk about the different facets of gun violence in America. So the argument was that certainly guns are a part of the debate, but so are things like social marginalization, alienation, mental health, emotional health. All of these things sort of factor into the type of violence that we're seeing as a result of gun violence.
Both of you work on campuses. You're both professors. Speak a little bit about students feeling safe. And we've talked so much with school safety about fortifying them or making the school itself safer. But on a college campus especially, there's a lot of open space for learning, which is a good thing. But now we have this element. So maybe speak to that, Areto. What are people talking about when it comes to making students feel safer?
Well, when it comes to feeling safer, first of all, it's very difficult to feel safe immediately after a tragedy like this, irrespective of what measures are in place. So the emotional well-being is something that I know my institution and our administration have been pushing to get students who are affected by the recent tragedy at Marjorie Stoneman Douglas a chance to air their concerns and also to write letters and such. As to direct measures that are being put in place, there are always conversations about installing additional card readers and such. But we should be careful when it comes to safety concerns, not to lose sight of some of the core issues at play here. One of those is the ongoing gun violence we have in this country and that has now come home to us here in South Florida once again.
Let's talk about policy. We saw the students obviously very raw with emotion after what happened, go to Tallahassee immediately. We saw them, at least one girl, burst into tears when the House decided not to take up a debate over banning assault rifles. So those students got a quick lesson in civics about how it's going to be difficult in some aspects when it comes to changing the law, changing policy. You are a constitutional expert, Areto. Speak to that a little bit about what happens now going forward when it comes to gun laws.
Well, one thing I should be clear about, notwithstanding any discussions about the Second Amendment that have happened already, none of the proposals I've read, including the ones you just aired, are subject to any sort of Second Amendment bar. In other words, the Second Amendment allows regulation of weapons that are not full regulation all the way up to a ban of weapons that are not in common use. But even weapons that are either in common use, such as or not so much in common use, can be regulated, but not completely barred. And even that is an open question. So, for example, a complete bar on AR-15s would be permissible. That's not being proposed right now. That would be permissible, at least according to at least four circuits in the United States Supreme, in the U.S. Federal court system. So we don't really have a Second Amendment problem with the measures such as age of 21 requirement, with measures such as any sort of registration requirements that have been discussed wouldn't run afoul of the Second Amendment. Second Amendment is not really an issue in this context. It really is more of a policy concern.
Yeah, so Brian, speak to that.
Yeah, well, I want to add that, you know, this is a really emotional time for young people in our community, right? I think it's an emotional time for a lot of, you know, all ages in our community, but you're starting to see, you know, our youth kind of step up to the plate. And I think one of the things that's really important for them to understand is that changing law is a process. Mm-hmm. It's a long process. It's a very painful process. And we're in that process right now. And so right now, the governor has put a plan forward. So are both the House and the Senate. They're putting their proposals on the floor. Those proposals have to be voted on, right? So as far as I understand, the committee has already passed something in the House. We're waiting for the Senate to vote. Those things will then go to the governor to sign mm-hmm. into law.
And let's put it into context for our viewers. We're recording this on a Thursday. They could actually be voting today. So by the
Absolutely.
Time this airs, we could see a bill that's passed that the governor may sign.
Right, or may not sign. He has vetoing authority, right? Mm-hmm. So he could veto. So I know there's some tense points in sort of discussion right now. For example, both the House and the Senate are expected to pass something that allows teachers to carry. It's a different environment. We can certainly parse that out. But the governor has already gone on record saying, I'm not for that. Whether or not that's a sticking point in which he vetoes, you know, legislation that makes it to his desk, we'll see. Right now, though, we certainly know that it's a time for action. And so I'm pretty confident that something's going to move through, you know, through the legislature and be signed into law.
Let's talk, and we were speaking earlier about the mental health aspect of this, because there it's not just about guns. We've talked about law enforcement
right.
and fortification and giving them broader authority to take guns away from people who may have some sort of mental instability. Talk about mental illness, because we were talking about statistics earlier that show or say that the majority of mentally ill people aren't offenders.
The first challenge is most suspects that actually conduct a mass shooting don't make it out alive, right? So we don't have a lot to go on in terms of what a profile of a mass shooter looks like, at least in this context, just looking at mass shooting incidents in the United States. So we still, you know, we're still a lot, there's still a lot to be uncovered. What we do know, though, is that it's probably reactive to think that mental illness plays a central role in mass shootings. And then we're also sort of creating a stigma among those that are mentally ill, mm-hmm. You know, that they're all capable of going out and becoming, you know, mass shooters. And that's mm-hmm. just not the case. It's a very, very, very small percentage. And in fact, as we were talking about earlier, he mentioned that that most mentally ill are more of a danger to themselves than anyone else in society. But one other point real quick is that I also think that we're unfortunately sort of bringing mental health and emotional health together mm. and sort of all underneath the sort of concept of mental health. And I think that's a disservice to those that are severely suffering.
Gentlemen, thank you so much for being here. We really appreciate it. We need to have you back and continue this conversation because there's so much to talk about related to this. We'll see what happens with the legislature as well. Thank you both. And if you have a comment on this or any topic from today's show, we'd love to hear from you. Please send us your take. You can always reach us on Twitter and Facebook @YourSouthFL. Send us a message or a video. We look forward to hearing from you.